Much. You see, I was right.
That was without preparing.
All right, so super excited to be here. This seems like a wonderful school with amazing people. And I'm very humbled to be in the speaker list, probably the youngest member. All right, so I'm going to talk about my passion of trying to model people out of historical footage, and it will become clear what I mean by historical footage in a second. I'm a professor at UW, University of Washington, and recently at Facebook as well. All right, so here's Tom Hanks, here's what I want to do. I want to create a model, three-dimensional model of Tom Hanks. I want to make sure that that model that I create is going to move and act like Tom Hanks. So it needs to be realistic, high detail, and so on. I want to animate it, so dynamic model, not just a static 3D. I want to be able to synthesize how he may look like if something. We'll talk about that. Over decades, like how would he look like when he's young, maybe how he looked like when he was younger, how he would look like in the future maybe. Can I predict all those things in the model? And finally, I want to be able to interact with the model. So can I have like a hologram of Tom Hanks here, and I want to ask him questions, interview him, have him answer. Sounds kind of hard, right? Okay, so how would you do that? Actually, I would love to. So here's like a big research problem. What do you think? How would you go about it? Right, for the aging. How are you going to get the data?
Historical footage.
Cool. Okay, so for aging, how about the 3D model? What do you do? I want it all in 3D, moving 3D. You guys all took computer vision classes. What are you going to do? Yeah.
We have some standard mesh that you try to deform so that it looks same shape as the space in the video, and then you...
Cool, yeah. Where are you going to take the mesh from? The standard one?
By scanning a bunch of people.
Scanning? Yeah, cool. Any other ideas? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Reconstruct from the web. All right, cool. So yeah, let's start from scanning. Seems like the first thing to do. And indeed, let me give an example of, there are a number of capture studios or rigs or big scanners out there now, really cool ones. So Microsoft, for example, that's a Seagraph paper from 2015, like a year ago, created this super cool studio. It's a big green room where the person stands in the middle and you have those stands with lots of cameras. It has 106 cameras, combination of infrared and RGB. Everything is hardware synced, calibrated. And so one of those stands, for example, looks like this. It's a combination of RGB. The blue ones are RGB. The red ones are infrared. And so it's carefully chosen setup that can capture really amazing shapes. So some examples, and they're dynamic. In a second, I'll show examples. Of what we did with that. So here are some examples of the people they captured. So they would bring a celebrity or some interesting character into the room, and there is a process to capture people and in the room. I'll talk about it in a second. And so we were lucky to try this green room in a class. Steve Seitz and I at UW, we invented this class, which was a virtual reality and augmented reality capstone. And I'm going to do a little bit of a promo to this class because it was so so interesting to do it. The students were basically the first developers of HoloLens in the world, probably, working with buggy code and really development code. We got about 25 HoloLenses, and they invented projects and implemented them, and actually some of them shipped them to the Microsoft store. So it was a really exciting time, kind of like startup. And let me show you, here's actually Alex Kipman, who is the lead on the HoloLens development team, the inventor of the HoloLens. Okay, and I'll show you a little video that looks like a promo video, but ignore the promo stuff. I just wanted to highlight some of the projects that they created because it's interesting to, it wasn't done before, so kind of interesting to look at it. This is a virtual augmented reality capstone. This is a class where students are divided into teams, and each team is developing an application or a game on a HoloLens device.
The name of our project is Dogfights. So what it is it's an augmented reality game for the HoloLens where you fly a virtual plane around the room, trying to avoid real-world objects as well as achieve objectives like flying through rings.
So you could tilt the phone left and the plane would turn left. This involved networking the Android phone with the HoloLens, and we ended up solving it using UDP packets.
We had a lot of help from Microsoft and our professors. We set the bar for whoever's coming in next. That's awesome.
And then we're putting it all on a HoloLens, a new medium for games that hasn't really been explored yet. So that's kind of the exciting part.
I'm working with a new entire technology as well as a new game engine for myself. I've never worked with Unity before, so getting to learn a lot of new areas and working with a lot of great people is something that's really fun for me.
We built a roller coaster application where you can build tracks and then watch animations. So you're currently in building mode. You've got a menu in front of you with a bunch of different track pieces, and in front of you, a little bit lower, you should just see the green pin, and if you place a track piece, you should have tracks building from it. So that is the build mode. Now you're in animation mode. If you look at their...
Yeah, so this kind of gives the idea. So these guys actually build this awesome. So in the computer science department, we have a big atrium, and so they build this rails that go through the whole atrium. Virtually, yeah. So you put the HoloLens on, and then you see all the rails, and you can. It's pretty insane. Okay, so one of the projects were particularly exciting to me is the holographic chess idea. So one of the groups was inspired by, the original Star Wars, the chess game that they had, and more recently in Harry Potter they have the wizard chess. If you haven't seen it, let me show you a little bit. Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas. That's from Harry Potter. Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas.
Knight to e5. Queen to e5. That's totally barbaric.
That's wizard's chess. I see.
So for them, it happens without glasses. They just make things work. So in our case, so the students wanted to do this idea exactly. But just with HoloLens, so two people can put HoloLenses on, and then you can project stuff on the floor in front of you, like a big chessboard, and play with dynamic figures. But we kind of pushed them, Steve and I, even further, and said, "Hey, how about the pieces will be the people? Will be like you guys." And so since we had access to this Microsoft Studio that I showed you in the beginning, that's exactly what we did. And so, actually, let me show the models first. We went there and we captured six different. Oh, you don't see it. And captured six different pieces. Now you see it. Where the four students were the the rook, the bishop, the pawn, and the knight. There we go. Okay? So here's the kind of one of the models. That's one of the students. Here's the bishop, the pawn, the knight. So Steve sides with the king. and I was a queen. All right, let's go back.
How was this captured?
In the Microsoft Studio, in this like the 100 camera thing. And so, and we carefully selected which dynamic, what kind of dynamics we're gonna do. So basically, there are all sorts of constraints that you need to take into account, like so that the models won't have holes. You need to move slowly so that, like, everything will be nicely, nicely reconstructed. Not too fast, so that, you know, particular clothing, as you can imagine, like, for example, specularities, very black, dark things won't work, things like that. Okay, so we came up with some activities. There's another one. Oops, where is it? Here we go. Some other ones, different representations of the mesh. All right, and so eventually the students came up with the following.
In HoloChess, we've brought the classic game of chess to life like never before. You can play anywhere, anytime, with a board that feels real, but it's not. Free from the constraints of reality, your board requires no setup, your game can persist indefinitely, and your pieces can obey your commands to hack each other to bits. To play with someone, open the menu and select Play Game. Select Create Session and have your opponent select the name of the session you created and then select Join. Other people can join afterwards as spectators. There are two ways to play HoloChess. The first is with gaze and gesture controls. Simply move your head to look at the piece you want to move, tap your thumb and forefinger together in front of you, look where you want to move the piece, and tap your finger again. This work.
All right, so so they basically made the Harry Potter chess come to life in a way. It was they had to build all sorts of plugins for the meshes to be imported to Holland, so it was a ton of work. Okay, so this is so these are the type of shapes that we can capture in one of the you know, the calibrated lots of cameras studio. There are other scanners. Make the shape.
Once the other person hits the 3D shape with the.
Oh, the other one. So this one is synthetic. The one that collapses is synthetic.
Yeah, but like how do you synthetically make it collapse?
Oh, so they just do like graphic stuff. So they basically ruin the mesh.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
But yeah, the students were amazing. They came up with all sorts of crazy tweaks to make it work. So there are other scanners out there. So here's, for example, like a big room with lots of cameras and calibrated and so on from Michael Black's group at Tübingen. They're focused on motion capture and body like very exact body modeling. There is one that I'm particularly inspired by, the light stage from Paul de Bevec's group at USC. They've been doing it for decades now. Here's Paul de Bevec. His light stages focus on faces, and so the idea that you have this rig with lots of lights, different color lights, and you turn on and off, they're calibrated to create really amazing high detail shapes. So this is President Obama in front of like a portable version of their light stage, and they get a shape like this. So they have a 3D Obama. And for example, if you think about kind of inspiring applications, one of the things that they achieved using the light stage is they had this big project to, this is actually the light stage, so the person sits inside it and the little things are the lights. So they took, they had a project to capture Holocaust survivors And so they had a person sitting inside, and over weeks, I think, they asked him questions, and he would answer, tell his stories. It's really preservation of history, right? Because at some point, Holocaust survivors will be all gone, but we want to preserve history in a really new way instead of just having books. What happened is that after they did the whole capture, and there was a ton of manual work inside here as well, combined with natural language processing and so on, but eventually you could see a hologram of the person sitting in front of you, and you could ask questions, and he would answer and tell his story. And so if you haven't seen this video on YouTube, I recommend it. I'm not going to show it here. Another one, of course, is like the classic, all the work that was done at CMU. Takeo showed all the amazing stuff that they did, and more recently, Yasser Sheikh and so on. So now the question is, so what I really want to see, kind of push it to the other extreme. So let's say that we don't have all that calibrated hardware sync, lots of camera stuff. Can we create 3D models and those amazing experiences with more and more from historical content? So what kind of historical content? It could be photos that you search on the internet. You can go to Google Image Search, search for Barack Obama, get a ton of photos. It could be your personal photo collection. Something to notice is that you get lots of photos of him, for example, but you also get interesting collections like Obama Young. Question? No? Obama Young, Obama with his family, places where he lived, all sorts of interesting things that you can't, you know, capture per se when you bring a person to a lab, but you do have this data that you can explore. In addition, you have videos. So in case of in case of Obama, he basically gave a weekly address to the nation, and so you have a ton of videos of him talking about all sorts of stuff over the last 8 years. And so there is also text, and there is audio. So can you combine all that stuff to some interesting experiences? And so as you'll see throughout the talk, I'm really excited about like the creating technical pieces, so we're inventing the algorithms, but also have an application or some kind of new visualization that comes with it. Okay, so unconstrained footage. On the one hand, it's really amazing data, lots of stuff. On the other hand, it's kind of a pie in the sky. So it's unconstrained, so very challenging. And I like to explain the challenges using not photos, but actually portraits, self-portraits of Rembrandt, because he's arguably the creator of the selfie. He painted more than 100 portraits of himself over about 40 years. And so if you look on them, it's really interesting to observe. So in when it goes from younger to older, and he looks like a different person. I don't know, I would never be able to recognize him from those two. So age is a big factor. The lighting changes the shape, the facial shape completely. Hairstyle, hats, his emotional state, and some of those he's smiling, and some of those he's more grumpy. That's also captured in the photos. And so on the one hand, it's very interesting data, but it's not calibrated, like not calibrated at all. How would you find correspondence between all those photos? So let's see. And so over the last several years, we created this, we started to focus on faces first, not on full people. And we created this really robust pipeline to how to process faces, and got to the point that we're at here. And let me explain the different blocks and the components. Okay, so essential first step in any face modeling type of application is that you need to detect the faces. You need to, a box around the face. You need to find the fiducial points. You need to find the points on like the eyes, the nose, the mouth, You need to be able to do face tracking, good face tracking. So if it's a video, you want to know that where the points move in every frame. Some of the classic works in this space is active appearance models, active shape models that let you detect about 60 points on the face, and then you can triangulate and get this sparse mesh. So there is a ton of work in this space. Not going to talk about it at all. With Takeo being the father of all of it, and there are nice packages now that you can use. People usually use, there is an interface at CMU that's pretty popular. There is DLIP. There are all sorts of cool detection algorithm out there with deep nets, without deep nets, ton of work. So only by having this component that you have points on faces and you can track faces, you can now align faces, right? So you can find rotation metrics, you can find the translation, the scale, and so on across many, many photos. So just by having this component, we can already come up with so many cool use cases. So for example, Shiri presented 2 days ago with Alyosha this really cool work of the Century of Portraits, where you just by aligning the photos and finding the right data, you can kind of flesh out all sorts of interesting things that happened in history, how people smile, how people change over time, how people react to cameras in different years, and so on. So I find it really exciting. Another type of application is what Alyosha talked about is we created this, we had this idea of how to organize personal photo collections. That was a while ago. I just want to show how alignment gives possibilities to cool applications. And so we took 20 years of photos, like any photo collection basically, over many years, 20 years of photos of this woman since she was a baby, and based on, and created this huge graph from a photo collection where each node is a photograph, and the connections, the edges, include similarities between every two photos. So similarity in terms of where the faces look into, the pose, similarity in terms of facial expression, is she smiling, non-smiling, and so on. Similarity in terms of kind of the hairstyle and the age and other things. That's basically it. So once we have this, once we define the edges and the nodes, that's a usual, like, simple graph traversal problem where you can find shortest paths in the graph. And so you can say that, hey, I want to start from this red photo, go to the green photo, and I can use Dijkstra and get a path. Okay? And the path is interesting because it takes into account the similarities. And so you will see that she's kind of smiling for a while, and then she rotates her head for a bit, and so on. So those paths, plus a neat observation that we proved in the paper that cross-dissolve actually can generate motion. So what is cross-dissolve? You take two random photos. You just vary the one coefficient, t, and you take 1 minus t multiplied by 1 photo plus. So it's basically kind of average of two photos from two random photos. So we proved under which conditions, when you do that, it can actually create motion. So if you do the cross-dissolve and you focus on the face, it kind of looks like she moves, the nose moves, right? But there is no actual motion that we introduced here. We didn't move pixels around. We just averaged the photos. So, apparently, if there is small, if the photos are aligned well, which is what the paths are doing, and up to two pixels error, this phenomena will happen always. So the paths plus this observation about cross dissolve can create this real-time system. Let me stop it for a second. Sorry about that. It's too loud. It can create this real-time system where you can take any photo collection and create those videos. And for the the queen, she had a 90th birthday, I think, this year, last year, and so. At this point.
So you don't have a chronological
constraint at all.
Like, it doesn't need to be chronological.
No, it doesn't. So in this case, so usually what happens is that in this work, we never identify the age. So it's just by timestamps. So in her case, we didn't have timestamps. So it's kind of like random order. But in the case of a personal photo collection, like from the camera, we can get the timestamps. And so it's using that.
I think one important thing is that this looks like a SIGGRAPH demo, but it's actually, you guys could just download and use this yourself.
Yeah,
so
it was.
Actually works.
Cool, yeah. So another, and they're just by alignment and active appearance models and so all those sorts of stuff, there are like lots of startups that are doing all sorts of fun things like putting masks on people and makeup and things like that. Okay, so now let's get to the next kind of big block of technical things that you need to do. So we can sparsely align faces, we can create cool applications. Now the next step, what I want to do is I want to be able to create dense reconstruction. So more than 60 points, sparse models and so on, actually a model per point without having a scanner, okay? No scanners, and also no... there is a big area of if you've done some face work, you know about morphable models and like using many scans of other people, doing linear combinations of those other people to create a new person and so on. So we're not doing any of that. Okay, so it's purely from the image data. So how should we go about it? So there is so we have one of those collections, right? And the first thing to do. The problem is that none of the structure for motion, multi-view type of algorithms won't work on this collection because it is the same person, same face, but it's not calibrated. He's in different expressions in every photo. The pose is unknown, the camera is unknown, lighting is crazy, and so on. And so it seems like it's very it's a very challenging problem, but one observation is that, yeah, the lighting is very different and changing, but it's actually very useful. And so instead of trying to overcome the problems that the lighting causes, we can use it. And the way we can use it is by, so 2 days ago, Shri and Takeo gave a really nice intro to photometric stereo and shape from shading. And so here is photometric stereo working in real life, on real photos. So what happens here, you take all the photos, you put every photo in a big matrix as a column. So you have matrix of all the photos. You run SVD on those photo on this matrix and look on rank 4, just rank 4, the first four components that you get in the V matrix. I'll show equations in a second. Now the first four components are going to be this. that will basically capture every shape of the person, so average bush out of all the collection. So you see that the expression is averaged out, but with different lighting directions. And it was proved that these first four PCA components represent surface normals and albedo. And since we have surface normals here, we can integrate and get the shape. Let me show you a bit.
After alignment, right?
After alignment, yeah. So assuming that it's like everything I'll describe assumes that you have all the previous blocks. So Takeo and Shri talked about this. So everything they talked about was assuming you have a scene that was captured with a single light source. So like there's this one light that comes to the scene. So then the whole rank 3 approximations and all that stuff work. And let me just describe reference to briefly. So assuming Lambertian model, so intensity is approximated by lighting vector 1/3 and dot product between the lighting and the normal and each and every point. So it's 1/3 multiplied by 3/1. And then when you have lots of photos, and it's so this part is kind of like shape room shading. How do you get normals from here? And this part is photometric stereo. Now that you have more than one photo, you can put them all in one big matrix. And you do SVD, you get UDV, and you can say that U square root of D, square root of D, V transpose is actually, you can approximate these as lighting and normals. So it's a multiplication between lighting and normals, where now you have the lighting of every one of the, F is the number of frames, number of images in M, and P is the number of pixels. And then you can recover the normals from here, assuming all the images have the same normals. So that's one set of normals. So that all works in the in what was described before. Now, in case, and the normal is looks like this, three components. Now, in case there are many unknown light sources, there is a generalization with spherical harmonics. So when you have only one light source, you can just say, okay, so these are free numbers. When you have many light sources, what you can do, just like when you have a function and you can say that, oh, let's represent it with Fourier, you can do, on a sphere, you can do the same thing and just say, we have this function of many lights, let's represent it with spherical harmonics, okay? It's a basis. And so instead of having dot product between light and normals, you will have intensity can be approximated by dot product between some coefficients and harmonics. And now it was proved by Basri and Jacobs and Ramamurthy and Hanrahan that 4, it kind of sounds like a magic number, but rank 4 instead of 3 actually approximates a lot of the lighting of the reflectance and then this combination approximates well the intensity. And so in photometric stereo case, you're doing the same factorization. You're just using rank 4 instead of rank 3. And and H looks really interesting. So apparently, the first four harmonics are just one with some scale factor 1 and X and Y and Z. Okay, so you can still get the normals from here and integrate and get the shape. And if you do, you can go. So 4D gives some approximation. It's an approximation. And then 9D, if you do rank 9, you'll get a better approximation, but it becomes nonlinear. So it looks like this. H will look like this. So the first ones are the normals, 1 and the normals, and then the rest look nonlinear. And there are actually really interesting, really new ideas that are going around that how do you do those things with deep nets? I said that. All right, cool. So let's say that we have this base shape. Now what we want to do, we actually want to include the expression and so on. But we have now a starting point. So for every photograph, we want to use the base shape plus the photograph to create a nice shape. So that will be the result for this particular photograph. So you have the 3D shape in the right expression, lots of details, and texture for every photo, but it will also be consistent across the photographs. I'll talk about it in a second. By the way, feel free to stop me and ask questions if you want to. Okay, so there are a bunch of steps to achieve that. And so base shape reconstruction, we talked about that. That comes from the whole collection with photometric stereo. Pose estimation. The next one will be pose estimation. We need really accurate 3D pose for every photograph. I'll talk about that briefly. Then we want to be able to, let's say we take the base shape, rotate it to the right pose. We want to be able to open the mouth a little bit to fit the image. So it's a 3D flow approach. Then we're going to use shading to refine the shape. So you see that more details appeared here. It's nicer. You can see the wrinkles now, all the high-frequency details. And finally, how do you get the texture? And it's not just taking the image and putting it on top of the shape. It's more like recovering a expression, kind of dynamic texture that will be consistent over all the photos, the different lighting and so on. Okay, so let's briefly do the pose estimation. This is pretty straightforward. The idea is the following. So we have an input with a very difficult pose. So it's a side view, so it's pretty difficult for typical algorithms. And so you can get an initial pose like this one, which looks pretty good, but it's not good enough for dense 3D reconstruction. And so we want to correct it a little bit by the following idea. Because you have the points, you have the alignment, yeah. So you can find the, you know, the rotation matrix and get the pose. Then you, based on the pose, and this is the base shape rotated to the right pose. Then you can take the base shape and the image in the right pose and kind of put the texture of the image on top of the base shape and unwarp it. You'll get that. So you see only half of the face because that's supposed to be a frontal pose. You see only half of the face because you only have it in the photo. That's all you have in the photo. Then you can do a cool thing that we're going to use a lot. So remember that matrix and the SVD. Let me go quickly there. This SVD idea. What you can do, so each of the images here can be projected onto this basis, and you can have a kind of a rank 4 approximation of each of the images in M. Okay? So this rank 4 approximation looks like this. And what happens is that you get the average shape, but with the lighting and colors of the input image. Once you achieve that, you can now render back to this original pose, this related version, and then calculate optical flow and iterate this whole thing. So why do we need to go through the relighting stuff and not just use this for optical flow? Because what happens is that to make sure that optical flow works, optical flow assumes brightness constancy. And so it assumes that corresponding pixels have the same colors, basically. And so if you'll not have the same lighting in your between the two images that you try to find correspondence between them, you won't be able to find good optical flow. So this relighting component is really critical. So this produces a nice pose. The next step is, so we have the now we have the model, the base model in the right pose, and now we want to, in this case, open the mouth a little bit, close the eyes. This is done with the 3D optical flow. The idea is the following, again, the same relighting idea. We have the base shape in the right pose. We can relight. We can create this base shape in the right in the right lighting, and then we'll try to optimize on the difference between the two. Specifically, what we'll do, we're looking for this vector F pair vertex. So this is a vertex on the 3D, on the base model. So we want to find this vector F after projection, and whatever intensity you get in this particular location. And compare it to the related texture and do it for every pixel with some regularization to make the flow small. So this is, I think the key point here is the relighting part that makes everything work. Okay, once Once you get the three float version, we are going through a shading refinement step, which I'm not going to describe, but it's basically doing fancy shape room shading, starting from this shape and making it as close as possible to the image. And so you start seeing the wrinkles and the details of the face, the pores and so on. Okay, so here are some results. So it's the same shape, just rotated to different views. So for example, it is known that photometric stereo methods they can show details, but they don't really, but only like in some views. That's what it's known. And we actually show that if you have enough data and lots of light variation, you can actually get pretty cool reconstructions also from side views. You can see the nose and so on, which are close to what scanners can produce.
Well, Ira, both in this one and the previous Barack Obama one,
mm-hmm.
to me it didn't look right, and I'm wondering if that's a...
Yeah, so it looks a bit, what?
If you just showed me the 3D model, I would not recognize Obama, whereas I think I would recognize Hillary in the 3D model. And I'm wondering maybe that's because his hair is such a salient feature, or...
It could be. Hair is actually pretty big. It's a pretty big deal. Yeah. We recognize, it is known that we recognize people a lot by their hairstyle and the rest. It's not only the face.
The other option, of course, is the albedo. It's another salient feature of Obama.
Yeah, so you need the texture. That's another thing. And a technical point is that all those reconstructions are up to some scale. So scale can never be recovered in dust. It's uncalibrated. And so the scale is basically invented.
But I guess maybe
so you can stretch it, you know, whatever you want.
Is there any ground truth? I mean, are you confident? Is there a way to evaluate this, the quality of the model, other than me looking at it and saying what I recognize?
Yeah, at this point, not really. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You have the ground truth for Obama, at least, right?
From Paul Debevoise. Yeah.
Well, I don't really, because it's not allowed to be shared. Yeah.
But you know, there's this line of work by Dan Hasnell who says that the exact 3D reconstruction for a particular face is not that critical. You can use sort of a template 3D reconstruction and now rotate any other face and you would still recognize that it would look. Which
yeah.
Probably the 3D component is not that.
Well, it depends. It depends what you want to do. So Tal wants to do face recognition. And for face recognition, maybe, I actually think maybe you don't need 3D at all
no,
for face recognition.
Side views and rotate
yeah.
to frontal views.
Right.
Using the totally
right.
Wrong 3D
right.
And a deep neural network recognizes it as the right.
Well, thing. Maybe it's fine for face recognition, but if you want to create, if you want to create a hologram of Obama and then with your kind of go around him and look how he looks like from the side, you don't want to see your shape, right, instead of him. Like, think about it.
No,
if you want an actual 3D, you want an actual 3D.
I'm not talking about the body. Okay,
yeah.
The face.
No, the face. Like, you want to, like, okay, so I'm going to create a teleportation application. You're talking with your mom. Mm-hmm. Do you want to, and you're looking at her face, and then you're moving a little bit, and so you see her from the side view. Do you want to see shape of Obama instead of your mom? Like, in face?
I think
so. Not really, right? No, I mean, you need the exact,
so
like, a
I
scanner
think
it time.
The other way around, going from side views to frontal views. I think as a profile, nose really matters the shape, but in the frontal view, the shape of the nose doesn't.
Yeah,
change
right. So I'm. Yes, but the whole point of reconstructing 3D is to be able to kind of walk around it and see what happens, right? So you need the side view.
Yeah. It wasn't saying. My question was, what is relating to what you said? Is it really what's more critical now?
Oh, it's a good question. Yeah, so we did some experiments. I'll talk a bit about recognition, but we didn't really do any recognition. It could be that 3D is not important at all for recognition, actually. Like, if you have enough photos and you train on those photos, it could be that you don't need 3D. Yes, I'm aware of this work, but anyway. Yeah, it could be.
Work to extend
okay, yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me progress. I'll show you the ears. Okay. Yeah. It's not going to work.
Why?
Because the whole thing is based on light variations.
What part of it is breaking?
Everything.
The matrix will be around less than 4. Right?
Yeah, you'll have like matrix that is, you won't be able to get the base shape. So you could think about like starting from a base shape from someone else and then going, but it's not going to work as well. You're not going to get the nice details and the high res stuff and so on. It's really critical to this line of work. So you need, it assumes that you have a ton of data. And this ton of data captured by different cameras, different locations, different lightings, and so on. Not going to work in any other case. Not going to work. But if you have ambient light and lab-controlled experiment, which is what, there's like 30 years of research about that, you can do multi-view stereo, you can do structure for motion stuff, and so on. This is more like how do you leverage the uncalibrated data, like very, very diverse data. Yeah?
Regarding expressions, let's say you have many images of beam carriers, the other doesn't have an initial expression.
What the base shape is going to do? Yeah, it's a good question. So it will just do the average.
But they are very different, like a very open mouth.
So you'll see a very blurry area around the mouth.
In the
beginning. In the beginning, the base shape will have very blurry. And then the three flow parts will have to work hard to recover the shape. Yeah, that's a good question. Okay, so let me show some. Now, so basically, it's a perfect, like a single view method now. Single view plus this big collection. So you can run it on any frame of a video and get a nice video, like shape in a video. Here's another one. This one is considered pretty challenging because he's always facing to one direction, pretty side view. Here's some more results where we also frontalize and then rotate wildly. This is the kind of the same pose as the video. I mean, the cool part is that you can, because of this, the last part where we reconstruct the details, you see the the wrinkles go away and come back, and you see the different things that are specific to expressions that you can reconstruct. All right, let's finish the story with texture estimation. So I'm only showing those gray shapes, right? But I actually want a real face with colors, but consistent over the different frames, and it has to be expression dependent. What I mean by that is that if a person is serious, then you don't see the wrinkles on the texture. But if they smile, I do want to see the wrinkles, and so the texture model has to take care of that. And so we are using again the big photo collection. So so if you'll take. To give intuition to how it works, if we take the big photo collection, after alignment, after all the stuff, we'll just average. It's kind of connected to your question. You'll see that the mouth is blurry. The eyes are okay because the alignment is mostly by the eyes. If you now take, so this is average of like 1,000 photos, the first one. And then if you'll do average after sparse alignment, kind of think those active appearance models, you have 60 points, now you can do some thin plate spline interpolation between them, and then average, it's nicer, so it looks better. If you do a dense alignment, we have a work that's called collection flow that is doing fancy optical flow thing in 2D. Not going to describe it here, but it's basically you can do per pixel alignment, so it looks a bit better. And then finally, if you do multi-scale blending, which I'll describe briefly in the next slide, you get a nice sharp average, so you can see the progression between the different methods. So it's kind of amazing that this is the average, that's just average of all the photos on the internet of Tom Hanks. And so it's you can actually see the different creases in his face and so on. So this multi-scale blending thing works the following. So if you have some target image, what you do, you have a pre-processing step where you basically calculate pyramids for every photo. So each column is a different photo out of the 1,000 photos in the collection. And then the different bands, frequency bands, correspond to different type of details. So these, like one of the levels are the details and the wrinkles. One of the levels is just skin color and light direction and so on. And when we get a new image, a new frame for a video, a new image, what we do, we say these little bars are the coefficients. So it's basically a combination of the different levels of the pyramids. And so you get this target and you say, oh, okay, so in the lowest level, I will do, it's all the same. So all the bars are in the same level. So it's basically just average of all these for my texture. In the next level, what I'll say, oh, okay, so he's smiling, so I should probably take like the smiling photo where I have teeth, should get higher weight, and this should have lower weight, but I'm still gonna, it's kind of weighted average now. And then as you go up with levels, you're gonna take more or less from the different pyramids because you want different types of details. That's the basic idea. And this can produce pretty cool texture. So here's on the left, you see the different photographs, different target photos. And on the right, you see a consistent texture model that is reconstructed. By consistent, I mean that it's all same colors, but it changes according to the expression. So you're going to use only the images. So I assume that you have like 1,000 photos of Tom Hanks, right?
So for each novel photo, you take some combination
of the ones that have teeth in the collection. Yeah, keep in mind, it always assumes that you have like unlimited data. All right. You can go ahead and run it on a video.
Rory, but somehow we've managed to attract this more amazing people. I don't know how we do it, but they seem to want to come and get involved with the madness, which is just all our gain.
Face. And there were times when I would be instructed that I had to stand on this box and hold this pole that they had put there, and then walk down and sit on that chair. And when I looked over at the monitor.
And since we did all the heavy lifting, like this whole huge pipeline, of dance reconstruction and dance flow, we can do animation as well. So here's an example. Oops.
Rory, but somehow we've managed to attract this more amazing people. I don't know how we do it, but they seem to want to come and get involved with the madness, which is just all our gain.
Face. And there were times when I would be instructed that I had to stand on this box and hold this pole that they had put there, and then walk down and sit on that chair. And when I looked over at the monitor,
with meeting me and understanding that I was going to be representing him somewhere, he probably wanted some other actor to play himself.
Okay, and some funny stuff. Wait.
I think it's very important to fix a broken system, to treat people with respect, and have confidence in our capacity to assimilate people. It's a very difficult bill to pass because there's a lot of moving parts, and the legislative process can be ugly. but it looks like they're making some progress.
Okay, so this summarizes the part where we build the technical pieces for good 3D reconstruction, but I really don't want to see like masks of faces when I don't know, in various applications. And so we wanted to go beyond that and create full full heads, let's say. And do like really nice animation with teeth. It's always, there are no teeth, people don't really look like that. There's some artifacts. And so we started to think how to go about it. How would you create like full heads and so on, and for animation? And looked on the whole literature in the last 20 years. And I'll show it because, I mean, those are also like a composition of basically all the related works in this space. So it's good for learning as well and understanding the area. And so what you'll see is trying to do animation on people. Most of these are, because this is just what worked, most of these are on controlled experiments where you put a person in the lab, have him, her say stuff, and then reanimate. Like frontal pose, captured in some particular pose because pose is a big issue in those. And sometimes people use as input different things. It could be a video that drives another character. It could be audio, could be text, all sorts of things. So it's like 20 years of research. So let's see what it's...
I never met Forrest Gump.
Yeah.
I never met Forrest Gump.
Ellen did not say these words. Ellen did not say these words.
When I was a child, we had a dance at my school on the first day of May. No one asked me to dance. No one. I went to the club.
Some of us are pretty funny.
Feeling kind of lonesome. Haven't slept a wink. I walk the floor and watch the door, and in between a drink.
Some teachers enthusiastically espouse the benefits to be gained from educational software.
The grammatical agriculturalists woke the beneficial corduroy.
You mean the voice?
CVPR is actual word in annual conference on computer vision and pattern recognition. It is considered at the conference with a very high impact factor and a high
So you see, like, there are problems in the mouth or the teeth are awful.
I've recently been given an extra dimension. Now that I'm 3D, I can be rendered with any lighting conditions that I want. And I can... Hello, I am the talking head created by the method in submission number 1706. Everything that I say in this video has never been recorded.
Virtuele medewerker hier op de universiteit. Ik kan praten doordat er stukjes originele audiovisuele spraak worden hergebruikt. Het systeem is gebaseerd op het maximaal...
Assume that it is the multiplicity of infection of the whole population.
The result is on the left.
Dad? Your letter came just in time. Gregson was asleep when he re-entered the cabin.
We show no real-time facial expression transfer results between different actors.
Yeah, he's not blinking.
Due to the estimation of reflectance and lighting in the scene, transfer results are very high quality, even if the source and target lighting differ.
We mustn't become complacent. We have been called upon to do his work. We have his gospel.
Here we show the scenario of a translator animating another person. Note that our approach runs in real time, while Garrido et al. Works offline. Here we show a comparison to Tees et al. Who rely on RGBD data. Both methods produce similar reenactment results. However, note that Tees...
Video.
I'm in a bottle. The first thing that I'd like to do
is to save every day until eternity passes away, just to spend them with you. If I could make days last forever, if words could make wishes come true, I'd save every day like a treasure, and then again, I would spend them with you.
I can steer my own avatar with. I can be very sad, or I can be really boring, or angry, or very happy, or...
That's a cool, that's a really, really recent work from Polyface Group. Okay, so here's a composition of all the face animation works in the last 20 or so years. So we wanted to try what we can do, assuming, so all these papers, they have all those artifacts and the teeth and the, you know, the other stuff, but they really work with really small data. They capture stuff in the lab, and then they try to reanimate and so on. Now, we have the ability now to use a ton of data in our pipeline, and so here's our take, and this is unpublished. So so I'm not going to describe a lot of it, I'll just show some results. Okay, so the way that we designed the our algorithm, so the input is audio, and the output is video. So here's the audio.
It's been less than a week since the deadliest mass shooting in American history. And foremost in all of our minds has been the loss and the grief felt by the people of Orlando. Especially, okay. It's been less than a week since the death.
So that's the audio, and it's long. And here is... here's the output from the audio. But assuming, I'll just tell you, I'll tell you afterwards.
It's been less than a week since the deadliest mass shooting in American history. And foremost in all of our minds has been the loss and the grief felt by the people of Orlando, especially our friends who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender. I visited with the families of many of the victims on Thursday, and one thing I told them is that they're not alone. The American people and people all over the world are standing with them, and we always will. The investigation is ongoing, but we know that the killer was an angry and disturbed individual who took in extremist information and propaganda over the internet and became radicalized. During his killing spree, he pledged allegiance to ISIL, a group that's called on people around the world to attack innocent civilians.
Okay, it's a long video, but... So this is the output. It was never generated. I mean, it never happened.
And the input is
It's audio.
And
okay, yeah. So the input is audio. Let me show it compared to ground truth, and I'll tell you what's going on here.
It's been
okay. So here is the comparison to ground, like to where the to a video where the audio was taken from. So this is the ground truth. This is. Our result.
It's been less than a week.
Oops. let me remove the sound of this one. I'll just keep this one.
It's been less than a week since the deadliest mass shooting.
No, they're not synchronized.
It's been less than a week since the deadliest mass shooting in American history. And foremost in all of our minds has been the loss and the grief felt by the people of Orlando, especially our friends who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender. I visited with the families of many of the victims on Thursday, and one thing I told them is that they're not alone. The American people and people all over the world are standing with them, and we always will. The investigation is ongoing, but we know that the killer was an angry and disturbed individual.
Okay, so what's up here? What's going on? What do you think about the one on the left? Yeah, good. So you could distinguish that it's not real, right? You still have issues with emotion, that's true. But in general, like...
Too smiling in the
outfit. Yeah, that's the emotion thing. Okay, I'll show you a bunch of other results. It's actually pretty. Okay.
He looks younger.
Hmm. Yeah. Probably it comes from a model, from all the photos. Okay, so here's what's going on. Key ideas. Not going to describe any of those, but there is a really cool network that we built, an LSTM RNN going from directly from audio features to no text in between. And that's a big difference from all the related work that go from audio to phonemes to text and then to like shapes and stuff. So there's directly from audio to shape, LSTM, long short-term memory, RNN. There is a big component of dynamic time warp to enable natural head pose. There is like, in addition, there is the whole pipeline for 3D is inside there. There are special things for teeth, chin, torso, proxies, and so on. And finally, we are using, we basically downloaded all the 300 weekly addresses that he gave in the last 8 years, processed all of them. It's about more than a million frames. And so we used all that data.
LSTM RNN Obama network?
Yes. It works only on Obama. Seriously, for now. Okay, some more results. So on the left, I'm going to show, you can do all sorts of actually cool things. Like, so here's an interview of him when he was young, and this is automatically generated.
Although I'm honored, and I think people can say that my election symbolizes some progress, at least within the small confines of the legal community, I think it's real important to keep the focus on the broader world out there and see that for a lot of kids, the doors that have been open to me aren't open to them.
Okay, here's another one. Oh, you've seen this one.
It's been less than a week.
Let's do the next one. So this one is, it's also kind of a, so it's, it can play different roles. It's kind of like a super resolution algorithm where you can, I mean, we're not actually using the video on the left, but we're just using the audio, so you can kind of zoom in into the person when you don't see, like, you don't see him, for example, here in some parts. It could be all sorts of things, so let's see this one.
Us showing respect for other people, us being thoughtful about other people's traditions, is something that Michelle and I try to teach our kids. You know, you talked about what we talk about over the dinner table. Mm-hmm. A lot of what we talk about over the dinner table is, you know, we live in a diverse world, and you know, you have to try to understand other people and stand in their shoes, and you don't make yourself bigger by putting other people down, and you don't
I'll show a final one.
United States.
You know, I think we're in a moment of history where probably the most important thing we need to do is to bring the country together. And one of the skills that I bring to bear is being able to pull together the different strands of American life and focus on them.
How does it affect the results?
Yeah,
we're doing those experiments now. It's important to have lots of data. That's the kind of conclusion. But I don't have any plots to show now. It's like in works, but I mean, you need lots of data. Like half of the data will not be enough, for example, for training the network and so on. It always assumes lots of Okay, so let's see. I'm going to do one little part, and then I'm happy to take questions, and then I will show some fun project as a final thing, and going to be done. So let me do this little thing first, and then we can discuss stuff a bit as a break. Okay, so obviously data is really important in all the work, in all that line of work. And so one thing that... and this is why I'm not really good at answering face recognition questions. So, because I never did face recognition actually. But one thing that I did want to get, I'm always interested in the 3D part. So, but I need lots of data for that. And so I was trying to find, but to get lots of data of faces and people for any application, you need to run face recognition first, which I didn't talk about it. But before the alignment step, how do you get all the photos of the same person, right? You need face recognition. And so so to get lots of data, we need to find a good face recognition algorithm. We started to look for a good face recognition algorithm. And we discovered that there are like, I don't know, tens of thousands of paper on face recognition, and I have no idea which one to use. So there is a benchmark. And face recognition actually is kind of considered solved, but I still don't know which one works better than others. There are just tons of paper. Just in 2016, there were 938 papers on face recognition. All of them seem to be different. There are like 34 patents and about 20 startups. So I have no idea. There was a benchmark. There is a LFW benchmark. But it's 15 years old. It's really small. It's like 15,000 photos in there of celebrities. And actually, only 5,000 are used for benchmarking. And what happens is that all the face recognition people used to go to this benchmark and say, hey, I got 99.97% accuracy on this benchmark. I'm the best. And then someone came and said, I got 99.76. And so it's really saturated at this point. And so we decided to kind of do to face recognition what ImageNet did to object recognition. Yeah. And we created the MegaFace benchmark. And so if you're interested in face recognition, check it out. So here's what's in the benchmark. And we didn't invent any new face recognition algorithms, just the benchmark so that people use. So it has three things in there. So one is it has 1 million destructor photographs of 690K unique people from Flickr. I'll explain. So destructor means that, I'll explain in a second, actually. It's related to the challenge that we ran. It has training data. So it has 4.7 million labeled photos of 670K individuals, also from Flickr. And it has test data, which is the standard test data that everyone uses. So there are two sets. One is FaceCrab. It's like a known data set in face recognition community of celebrities from the internet. And there is one that we added, which is FGNet, which is an aging data set. It's also real uncalibrated data. It's super difficult set where you can find some people labeled like individuals, and you can find some people where you have different photos even across, like like the difference between them is like 40 years difference and so on. Yeah. Yeah, we didn't do it yet. And also, I think that we didn't want to introduce any bias to the system. Like Alyosha told us that you cannot use the same data set for training and testing. So we're following his. So if you're using the same data set, you can be biased. Like you can kind of overfeed the type of data, like overfeed Flickr. Yeah, but everything was taken from Flickr, and it anyway. So yeah. Could be, yeah. It's interesting. Maybe in the future. Okay. So we ran two challenges. So one is you're allowed to train on whatever you want, and so companies like Google, for example, can train on the whole world. That's fine. And you test with our test data, the two sets, plus 1 million destructors. So the two sets are small sets, as was done before, but and now we add noise to the system. So it's the test data, so you still have, like, you have a photo of a person and you have a photo of a person in the database, but instead of matching, find a match between those two photos, while you have in your database, you have like 10 other photos of, or like 100 other photos of different people, and so you have to find a match out of the 101 photos. Now you're gonna need to find a match between million and one photos. Okay, no, million plus 100 plus one photos, okay? So that's the test. And this is to test how if the system is really robust. And challenge two, you have to train on our data and test us here. And the idea here is because when we ran the challenge number one, we had, for example, Google that was winning the challenge. And so, and it's really, we wanted to try to level the playing field, to try to understand what is the difference between the actual algorithms. And is it the data or the algorithm? How do I know? Because no one else has data like Google and Facebook and so on. To actually solve the face recognition problem, we need to allow the whole world to try to compete and create algorithms on the same data. So that was the goal of challenge number two, to level up the field. All right, so some interesting results. So this is this plot shows on the y-axis you have rank one identification accuracy. So basically, I found my match. Is it number one? Is it like that's the person? Is it in place number one? And on the x-axis you have the number of destructors in the when you do the matching. How much noise do you have? And so 10, it's basically what was benchmarked before. And so if you look, most of the matches are around 100 and 90, and it's exactly what people report. Now, if you go to the million scale and you do exactly the same testing, just with more noise in the system, you suddenly start seeing all the differences across the algorithms, which is really interesting. And so you discover that on this is challenge number one. So you discover that FaceNet of Google is actually, that's the best. And then you discover that Tencent, which is another company in China, they're close. And then you see all the others. And the dashed lines are the ones that use lots of data for training. And the solid ones are the ones that use small amounts of data for training. And so this, for example, this like salmon colored line is actually really, really interesting. This is from Beijing University, because they use small training data and they're still kind of doing pretty well. So there are all sorts of interesting conclusions here, things that we can talk about it, but I'm going to just briefly state those things. And you can see the website. It's megaface.cs.washington.edu.
What's the axis?
X is the number of destructors. So like how much noise you put in the system. Now, what I showed here was on the aging test set. And so it's a very difficult test set. Usually, all the algorithms are very much tuned to celebrity data sets. And so you can see that on celebrity data set, indeed, the situation, you also see a degradation in accuracies when you put more noise into the system. But it's not as bad as in the other set. It means that they are very much tuned to celebrities. But you still see, it's not as, so for celebrities, everyone is here. Okay, almost everyone, except for like really stupid algorithms, which is like that's ours actually. So I'm allowed to say that. So everyone around 100%. But when you add noise to the system, you still see the difference.
Were there celebrities in your training data?
I cannot promise that there weren't, but the probability that, and based on our experiments, there are no celebrities. But it could be that on Flickr people put photos of celebrities, but not as much as, you know, it's a celebrity data set. And also it's very big, so the chances are smaller. On challenge number two, when everyone required to train our data, we got rid of the companies because they didn't want to train our data. So no Google here. It's very new. And so we have actually similar, the training data seems to be pretty good. We have similar behavior that on small scale, people are close to 100%. On big scale, it's there is a diversity in the results. And actually, on aging, it's interesting because our data doesn't have a ton of age difference to train on. And so it's doing well on small scale, but not getting to 100%. With our training data, people, and then at here they're not doing well. Which is
the previous slide for a second?
This one? Yeah.
Did you compare the results of these methods on challenge two versus challenge?
Yeah. So there are like really interesting things that you can discover. So these are different sets of people, but there is a subset of groups that participated in both. For example, there is one startup, 3DV, that obviously didn't have access to lots of data. And so in challenge number one, they did really badly. They were one of the worst. But in challenge number two, when they trained with our data, they're somewhere here. So they're one of the best ones. So that was interesting, right?
And who deteriorated significantly?
Deteriorated significantly. Actually, the ones that participated, they were pretty good in both. Not everyone participated in challenge two yet. It's very new. So we'll see. I have 5 minutes? Oh, okay. I'm doing an hour, right? Oh, because we started late?
Yeah.
Okay. So let me just go quickly
to... More for me,
I'll skip some stuff I'll just do the fun part. Okay, so yeah, feel free to ask me questions about all those stuff afterwards. I'll probably take a bit more than 5 minutes, but I'll try to be on time. Okay, so I'll finish with a kind of fun project that was a SIGGRAPH paper this year. It's called Transfiguring Portrait. And so here's the idea. Okay, so that's me. And I wanted to know, I wanted to know, will I look good with black hair? But it's tough, right? I don't want to sell in color my hair to dye my hair to black without me knowing if it's going to look good or not. I don't want to do it physically. So instead, I decided to create this system that allows me to put a photo and just render myself with black hair. Here are different styles of black hair. Render myself with curly hair. And in fact, the system works as follows. So kind of imagine a Google image search type of engine. And you can type any query. You give a photo, and you type any query, any text query, whatever you want. Like, you can type India if you want. And you get, well, in this case, me in Indian clothing. So that's kind of cool. Or you can even go back in time. You can write 1930, right? That's, and you get the person in 1930. And so let me explain a bit what's going on here. So there is it is known that by changing hairstyles, hair colors, there is dramatic appearance change. The way that the person looks like. And it's actually used pretty heavily. And if you've seen the show, The Americans, anyone watch the show? Yes? Oh, cool. Okay, so the show looks like almost no one watched it. But it's really cool. So it's basically about a family that, a Russian family, it's actually not as funny now, but a Russian family that comes into the US. They're KGB agents. They pretend to be Americans, and they live in the U.S. for like 20 years and so on. And so they, from time to time, they're doing all sorts of operations. And the way they disguise themselves, they change their hairstyles. And so here's Carrie Russell, the main actress that is changing herself. And it's actually quite amazing when people change hairstyles, hair colors. They do look pretty. It's harder to recognize. It's related to the Obama comment, right? You can't recognize him just from the face shape. It's like the hair actually is doing a lot of it. Okay, so in the heart of the system that I showed, there is a composite component, and composites go back to like the 18th century. Here is an average of all the Boston physicians in the 18th century. People like arcade photography. So like you put a wooden board with cutouts inside, and you stick your head inside, try to imagine yourself in cool scenarios, funny situations, and so on. There is, it's used in movies. So actually I discovered this one not so like a while ago, and it's, if you've seen the movie The Shining, and you know about this, there is like, it's this photograph that appears on the wall in the end of the movie. And so Jack Nicholson is here, and all those people from 1920s. And so if you wonder how this photo was made, it's actually like, that's an exact photo from 1920, but it was a different guy. And so what Kubrick did, he explained it. He said that it's a photograph taken in 1921, which he found in the picture library. I originally planned to shoot it and use extras, but it proved impossible to make them look as good as the people in the photograph. So I very carefully photographed Jack Nicholson, matching the angle and the lighting of the 1921 photograph. The photograph of Jack's face was then airbrushed into the main photograph, and I think the result looked perfect. So that's exactly what we did in the system, actually. So here's the basic idea. Let's say that I want to imagine how Clooney looks like with curly hair. So I can, there's lots of literature on face swapping and so on. So I can say, hey, I'm going to take someone with curly hair. I'm going to take face of Clooney, put him inside this guy, and get the result. So that's, even if the result is really nicely blended and so on, the problem is that the identity is gone. He doesn't look like Clooney anymore. Like something happened to the chin, the face size, it seems kind of unproportional and so on. So the idea is use the internet and find a more appropriate photo of someone else with a curly hair. So that will be a good composite. And it's an idea of doppelgangers. So if you're going to use big data, and we can actually have photos of people all around the world, there must be a doppelganger for each of you somewhere out there. Okay? So you'll find that doppelganger, but someone that has curly hair in this case, and then we'll composite you into the someone. So here's a quick, just a few more minutes, a quick overview. So here's Carrie Russell, and I want to see how she looks like with curly hair. So what it's doing, it's going to the internet looking for all the people with curly hair, doing face processing, all sorts of stuff like face recognition, gender, age, 3D pose, all those things. The computing skin masks, so all the skin areas, all the hair areas, every pixel is labeled. Finds doppelganger set, and then blends into those highly ranked people. And that's the result. So I'm going to skip the whole system. Just going to say that the 3D pose is coming from the 3D pipeline of ours. All those things are dedicated deep nets that we trained. All sorts of stuff. So it's lighting and pose and face recognition, so similar features, and skin masks, so similar contours of the face and so on. And so once we found the good matches, and let's say that this is a match, then we compute where the skin is and get a blend. There is an aging component that I didn't describe. It's another work of us. I'm going to just skip it. But you can potentially search for like a different age 25, male, for example, for this baby. You can age progress the face first and then blend it into the matches. And so let me just, using also lots of data from the internet. Creates models for different ages, finds flaws, textures, and so on. And can predict how, just for the face part, how a person can look like in older age. Actually, can predict all the ages. Some examples. Okay, so this one is actually fun. So once you combine the two pipelines of, you can age progress the face, and then find a good match, you can start predicting how this baby will look like in the different ages. This is not never tested with ground truth. No evaluations. Okay, so I'm very passionate about the missing children problem, and so we're trying to do all the age progression and blending to help. There are millions of children apparently around the world, and lots of organizations that we work with. And so actually blending into age progression of the face is just one step towards trying to find kids, because what happens usually is that if a child goes missing, the bad guys usually color dye the hair or change the hairstyle and so on, and so it becomes impossible to recognize even with good face recognition algorithms. So blending into trying different appearances is really important for that part. The system can get multiple inputs, and then kind of create almost a new personal photo collection for a person. Like in 19, here's like a photo collection of how Carrie Russell may look like in 1930. And because we use multiple inputs, so she's in different expressions, like she can smile and not. It's not only one photo then, not the same face everywhere. It's interesting to see which photos were used to create those. So these are the original photographs. She's with all sorts of hairstyles. These are the original photos. You can imagine how an actor will look like in a new role. Here's Kate Blanchett, and we wanted to see how she looks like acting Bob Dylan. So we created her as Bob Dylan. She actually did play Bob Dylan in I'm Not There, there's a movie, and then she transformed herself to be like this. And of course, I tried it on myself. So it's like one photo of me with a ton of different queries. So dreadlocks, different hairstyles, shaved head, all sorts of traditional clothing, hairstyles and heads. All right, and this is it. Thank you. Happy to answer questions. Yeah?
When you were showing matching the masks to the video, was that working in real time?
No. So it's a good question. It was about a second per frame. So it's not real time.
Okay.
Yeah.
When you did a historical composition, you don't at all change the makeup and the style of the eyebrows,
right.
All kinds of stuff that are very time period. Do you have any idea of how you do something like that?
Yeah, you're right. So for now, we're not doing any change of the face at all, only for like color transforms and so on. It's interesting. Yeah, it's a good idea. I mean, there are even companies and so on that do like makeup, right, where you can try out makeup, so you can use similar things. You'll have to detect really well, in addition to skin area, you have to detect really well the lips, the eyebrows, the all the different features. Which, if you collect enough data, you'll be able to. I mean, yeah, we didn't do it, but it should be fun.
In the last CCD, the face demonstrated the online. What is?
Yeah, I showed them in the composition video. So what they do, they use they basically they work only on the mouth area. And they use a target video, so they have a target video, and they use the morphal model AM type of techniques to create a kind of a model of the source and try to manipulate the lips of the target video. So it doesn't use lots of data. It's just two videos. It has it's cool. It's real time. It has its problems in like the teeth area, and there are lots of artifacts. They didn't demonstrate an actual, long talking sequence, right? Because it's very hard to do in this type of method. They could like open the mouth a little bit, talk a little bit, but it has to be a very carefully selected sequence to make it work. Yeah. I mean, it's cool that it's real time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With so many people in the world and so many pictures on the internet, isn't there a picture which looks like you with any, even without doing anything?
Huh, that's a good question. Wait, but why do you need it?
it is.
Here's me.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I mean, there are people who look
like double,
like me, or who look like you.
Yeah, right.
And I guess
you want to find your doppelganger.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like running face recognition on the whole world.
That's right.
It's kind of fun, yeah.
Well, now that you're on Facebook, you can do it.
Yeah.
Is it fair to say that any picture that you're trying to create, any picture, there is a picture that is pretty close to it out there?
Yeah, that's the whole point, that you're looking for someone, not for the whole pictures. You don't want the, you want the hair to be different, but you want the, you know, all the like light pose and skin be the same in that other person. Yeah. That's the whole point. Otherwise, it doesn't work well, right? Yeah, so it's a few things. It's one, obviously, not enough data, totally. That's where we, that's the kind of the magic. And the other one is that we have this really nice pipeline over the years that, like, carefully modeling all sorts of aspects of faces that it's hard to achieve. Like, it took us a bunch of time to do it. Yeah. All right.
Thank you. Very much.